are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Theater 100. Today we're going to spend some time talking about multicultural theater and musical theater. And before that, we're going to spend a little bit of time going back in history and doing a little bit of reflection on the theater of France and Spain in the 15th and 16th century. So we've got a lot to cover today, but before we do all of that, I do want to remind you that we are live and online. We do have a question for the day, which I'm going to give you in a second. You can always call us with your response at 1-800-339-1193 or type in your response at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. Our question for the day is, why might theater be important to groups who have traditionally been discriminated against? What power does theater possess that might be attractive to groups trying to increase a sense of unity and support in a community? And so you can see it there on the screen as well. That's something for you to ponder today. We are going to be talking about theater of diversity. So I'd be looking forward to your responses. And do remember, you get extra credit every time you call in or type a response in. And those will be tallied up at the end of the year and added to your grade. So I want to encourage you guys to keep doing that. And on that note, while you guys are thinking of a response to type in or call in, I do want to remind you that by tomorrow at midnight, you will need to have taken your midterm. If you have not taken your midterm, you will be dropped from the class automatically. So I want to encourage you to make sure that you get on and do that. I know I sent a message on the announcements board on Blackboard earlier this week, but I want to remind you again to do it. No exceptions, so if you don't do it, you're going to end up getting dropped from the class, and I'm sure you don't want that to happen after you've put so much effort into the class and we're almost done. So it would be such a waste if you got dropped, so make sure that you do take the test. I also want to remind you guys that next week here on campus at Dominguez Hills, this is our spring break. So next week we will not be having any class. We won't be broadcasting a lecture. There won't be any discussion board due. There won't be any tests or anything. So please make a note of that so that you are aware and you're not surprised when you try to tune in next week and there's nobody there. We will resume the next week and then we'll have another, I think, 5 or 6 broadcasts before the end of the semester. All right, so we're going to get going with our reflection on theater history today, and we're going to talk about the theater of France and Spain and what was happening in France and Spain during the 15th and 16th century. Well, this was the age of absolutism, and there were two kings, Louis XIV in France and Philip II in Spain, and they ruled with absolute power. And they use the theater to glorify their own reign and their own power. And that's why it's called the Age of Absolutism, is because there was such a strong monarchy in place in both countries. The sorts of theater that existed at the time, again, was mostly there to sort of celebrate the monarchy and to sort of showcase the power that was existent, especially in France. And so there were very elegant productions that were done mainly on the estate of the king. And they occasionally even featured aristocracy in the plays themselves, dressed up in obviously elaborate costumes and sometimes parading about also in the Ballet du Cour, which was something that was also started at this time by Louis XIV, a style of dancing that we now know as ballet. Order was really important to Louis XIV, so much so that even the gardens in his palace had geometric shapes and were highly organized. And in this way, this translated also to the sorts of theater that would be being produced. They followed the sort of the Greek dramatic action, but there was a lot of French dogma that went along and new rules that were being created for the order of French drama that was supposed to be created at the time. For instance, all plays should be written in the quatrain, which is a meter that's used. You might be familiar with iambic pentameter. The French use the quatrain, and that is a set of 16 beats in French, and everything had to be written in that. They also had five acts. That was important. There should be no humor in tragedy. Tragedy should always end sadly. There was a certain decorum that always needed to be followed. There was an importance placed on verisimilitude and the three unities, unity of space, time, and location. And all the playwrights of the time really followed this, including Molière, Corneille, and Racine. So I see before we move on that someone has called in to answer our question of the day. So let's take that call before we move on with our theater history today. Hi, Katie.
Hi.
So what did you want to say about why you think theater might be important to groups who've sort of traditionally been discriminated against?
Well, I think it gives them a voice to be heard. It's a way for them to communicate their values, and it gives them freedom to express themselves without judgment.
Absolutely. So in this case, we're talking about using theater as a platform for social change. And we can see that that's happened really over and over again throughout history. More recently, in the 19th, 20th, and 21st century, we see it as a form of a form used for social change among minority groups, which wasn't necessarily true in the past. But I think throughout history, we can see that groups tend to use theater to speak about whatever their own issues are, their problems, or the things that they want to think about a lot. And as we have a growing middle class and a group of people that have more and more social and political power, we see that the theater comes to be in use for them as well. So thank you for calling, Katie. Always a pleasure to talk to you.
You too. Thank you.
So yes, Katie's right. And I always enjoy hearing from her. I wish more of you would call. All right. So let's move on. We were just talking about the French forms of theater. And one of the great French playwrights is Molière. In fact, many, many people like to compare Molière to Shakespeare. He was a fantastic playwright, and he wrote and is known for sort of the development of comedy of manners, which is a sort of theater that is filled with lots of wit, repartee, mistaken identity, usually making fun of the upper classes. And this play in particular, which we're going to take a look at, The Misanthrope, is about a gentleman who, as the title states, does not like humanity at all and finds lots of reasons to complain about them. And in this little clip, we're going to hear about his dislike for mankind. So let's take a look at this clip from The Misanthrope.
What have I done, Alcest? Is this quite just? My God, you want to die of self-disgust. I see you almost hug a man to death, exclaim for joy until you're out of breath. Then when I ask you who was that, I find that you can barely bring his name to mind. Once the man's back is turned, you cease to love him and speak with absolute indifference of him. If I caught myself behaving in such a way, I'd hang myself for shame without delay.
It hardly seems a hanging matter to me. I hope you'll take it graciously if I extend myself a slight reprieve and live a little longer by your leave.
How dare you joke about a crime so grave?
What crime? How else are people to behave?
I'd have them be sincere and never part with any word that isn't from the heart.
If someone greets us with a show of pleasure, it's but polite to give him equal measure.
No, no. This formula you would have me follow, however fashionably false and hollow. Esteem is founded on comparison. To honor all men is to honor none. I spurn the easy tribute of a heart which will not set the worthy man apart. I choose, sir, to be chosen. And in fine, the friend of mankind is no friend of mine.
In polite society, custom decrees that we show certain outward courtesies.
Ah, no, we must condemn with all our faults this false and artificial intercourse. Let men behave like men. Let them display their inmost hearts in everything they say.
In certain cases, it would be uncouth and most absurd to speak the native truth. Wouldn't the social fabric come undone if we were wholly frank with everyone? This philosophic rage is a bit extreme. You've no idea how comical you seem. The world won't change, whatever you say or do. And since plain speaking means so much to you, I'll tell you plainly that by being frank, you've earned the reputation of a crank.
So much the better. Just what I wish to hear. No news could be more pleasing to my ear. All men are so detestable in my eyes. I should be sorry if they thought me wise.
This hatred's very sweeping, is it not?
Quite right. I hate the whole degraded lot. Notice how tolerant people choose to be toward that scoundrel who's at law with me. His social polish can't conceal his nature. One sees at once that he's a...
So there we see the main character, whom the play is named after, speaking to a lot of different things. And it's a message that Molière kind of sends over and over again in all of his works, which is that he sort of has this disdain for the way that the upper classes behave. Very false, very sort of preening and fawning, and being polite to people that he doesn't feel deserve politeness. And so in this case, the main character sort of translates that in a disdain for everybody. Everybody's acting like that because, of course, he's obviously mainly... hanging out with the upper classes. So this was a real sort of theme throughout Molière's work, and he did it in a very funny way, and he would take down the upper class a lot in many of his plays, and he was very well known for it. Well, let's get on to Spain. In 1556, Philip II became King of Spain, and at that time it was the most powerful nation in the world. There's a picture of him behind me. They had colonies in the Americas, and they also had dealings with Italy, and they had possessions in Asia and Africa, and the church was very powerful. It had almost a medieval hold over the people, very strict, very religious country. And of course, the Inquisition, which had happened just shortly before this, sort of guaranteed people's loyalty to the church because they were afraid. They didn't want to be taken and tortured and interrogated. The Jews and the Moors had been cast out of Spain at this point, but their influence still had an impression that was left. And as a result, women were sort of treated with a suspicious control, and they were kept in seclusion, and they were denied a great many freedoms and rights. And as a result of that, when women went to go see the theater, they had to see it in the casuela, which was a separate area behind where the men sat. It was often was definitely sequestered from where the men were, and sometimes even had sort of curtains that hung around it that were somewhat translucent. The women could sort of see out of it, but it would make it difficult to see them inside. So there was this feeling that women should be kept separate, and that was sort of taken on from a lot of the Islamic traditions that were left over in Spain after the Moors had lived there. Women were allowed to perform in plays, but only if they had a brother or a father who was also an actor in the company, and then therefore could guarantee their chastity while they were in the play. Spain was obsessed with honor and order and women, and so it's no surprise that one of the most popular plays was eventually Don Juan, which originally was a novel, and this is a story about a ladies' man who deals with, you know, is very popular with the ladies and also has these adventures that show his courage. And also another play called The Trickster of Sevilla, which was by Tirso de Molina, there's a picture of him behind me as well, a monk who wrote about a great hero who conquered many villains. So Jordan O and Noah have also written in to answer our question of the day, so I want to catch theirs before we move on. Jordan says, I think that in addition to giving people a voice, theater also offers a unique way for other groups of people to learn about certain social issues they may not encounter in their everyday lives. Absolutely. Noah says, I think theater is especially important to these groups because it can inform and educate others about their society, traditions, and values. It can also show others that they are not really that fundamentally different. Oh, I agree with that, definitely, Noah. And Nicole says, I think theater would be important to groups who have been discriminated against because it is a healthy way to let off a lot of feelings. Actress Helena Bonham Carter, who often plays very intense characters that are often screaming lines, admitted she uses her acting as a way to relieve unwanted energy and stress. Likewise, I feel performing would be a great alternative to being bitter about mistreatment from the past. Absolutely. So I think all those answers are absolutely wonderful. I think being heard and feeling like one is being heard, whether it be in simple one-on-one interpersonal relationships or in the culture as a whole, is a really important part of feeling happy and adjusted in life. We want to feel like people are listening to us and paying attention to us and respecting us. And so the theater gives a sort of platform for those things, as Nicole was saying, to injustices that have happened in the past and feelings that may be still being harbored by certain racial groups, cultural groups, or religious groups for that matter. So these are really important ways for them to heal, as well as to communicate with the society as a whole, as well as to make interesting works of art that can be compelling and can also show us that, as I think Noah said, that we're not that different really after all. Wonderful. All right, well, that finishes up our section on French and Spanish theater history. We're going to move on right now to the theater of diversity. You can continue typing in or calling in to answer our question of the day. This is chapter 16, and what we're going to really talk about in this section is how theater is a voice for a great many, a wide variety of cultures, races, and, as I even said, religious groups or spiritual beliefs. And in America, this has become incredibly important, obviously, because we're a very diverse nation. We're sort of based and founded on diversity, on the idea that anyone can come here and become an American simply by adhering to a certain set of beliefs and a economic and political system, right? So what makes you American isn't where you were born, it's what your beliefs are. And that is very different from a wide variety of nations that are out there. And as a result of that, of course, we have a theater that represents those ideas and is representative of a wide variety of cultures. When the 19th century came in and we had masses of people immigrating from Europe over into America, producers began even encouraging plays that focused on certain groups, such as at this time, these are the two, several major groups were the Irish, the Germans, and the Poles. These were large groups of people that were coming in from other countries and emigrating to America. And at that time, these were also the sorts of people that might be going to the theater because they were working class folk. And of course, so they wanted to start to gear the theater towards them. By the time the 20th century arrives, there are flourishing theaters in Harlem for blacks in downtown New York for Yiddish theater groups and throughout the Southwest for Hispanic theater. And when we look at the development of the American form, we will see how the plays of Tennessee Williams, Eugene O'Neill, and Arthur Miller are not very much unlike the works of Lorraine Hansberry, Lillian Hellman, or Luis Valdez, in that they represent oppression experienced by particular individual ethnic groups attempting to pursue the American dream. So we're going to take a look at some of these individual groups and kind of talk about the developments over time and how their own theatrical voices developed within this structure. So obviously, African American theater, when African Americans came to America, they were brought here primarily as slaves and they lived on plantations. And so, of course, there wasn't a lot of theater that was being performed by African Americans. Even once the slaves were freed, there was a huge amount of segregation. But there was a lot of theater that showed early stereotyping of blacks. For instance, whites would often, or Caucasians would often put black makeup or black coal onto their faces and do a type of theater called blackface, in which they would portray, often in derogatory ways, African Americans and slaves. And creating a lot of and fulfilling a lot of stereotypes, and they mocked the culture, and it was often used sort of as a tool for humor. Obviously, African Americans became very resentful of these performances, and they, once they were freed, sought, obviously, as many people do, sought ways to get into the entertainment industry, because there were people that enjoyed performing, whether it be music or theater. Minstrel groups became a very big thing that grew out of that, and these were groups that played music and did sort of a variety act of things that might be dancing, singing, maybe some jokes or short storytelling or a monologue. And these minstrel groups were where African Americans saw their first inroads into the world of the theater. What's strange about this is that even though they were making these inroads, even African Americans, as they were brought into these minstrel groups, were often expected to be derogatory towards themselves and to portray and to continue to portray these stereotypes in order to get work. So we have this weird irony in which we have people gaining limited amounts of freedoms and rights by actually being able to perform on the stage, and at the same time only being able to do that by degrading their own race, which was very interesting. And in an addendum to that, many African Americans were actually asked to even put more black on their face to make themselves look darker. So it's a very sad and sort of disturbing part of American theater history. Eventually, Thomas Rice in the 1820s sort of takes back the art form of the minstrel group, and he turns it into something very different. He turns it into something very elegant and very proper. He puts all the black entertainers that are performing in his groups in top hats and tuxedos and gloves, and they sing these beautiful songs and they do these very elegant dances, and he really takes back the form and he popularizes it in a way that it wasn't popular before, because it gains wide popularity across groups of African Americans as well as whites. And so that was a really wonderful transformation of that. Even at the same time, the Jim Crow laws still existed, so these people that were performing in oftentimes white-only theaters would have to go through these different entrances and have different dressing rooms from everyone else, and often were not even allowed to stay in the facilities to eat or drink afterwards. So a lot of very strange things happening. The Christy Minstrels came about as well, and they were very, very popular. And they gained international fame and went all over the world performing. There were many at this time that were also trying to make authentic portrayals. The African American Grove Company, Ira Aldridge, who was a very well-known African American actor who actually started the African Grove Theater, was actually forced to leave the country because he couldn't really make a living performing in the way that he wanted to. And so he actually ended up going over to England and France and performing there, and became very well known as a serious actor as well as a Shakespearean actor. Burt Williams and the Black Musical Company became very well known. Langston Hughes and the Harlem Renaissance. All of these things made great advances in portraying African Americans in a more human way, in a more realistic way, and were very important steps in representations of African Americans in the performance world. And then, of course, after that, we get Childress, we get Lorraine Hansberry, Baraka, Nezake Sheng, Pearl Cleage, and August Wilson. All of these are playwrights moving us all the way up into the 19th and 20th century that began writing plays for the African Americans and for the experience that they had gone through, and became very respected and were talking to specifically the African American experience. For instance, August Wilson, who was born in 1945, is still alive today, wrote and is continued to writing a cycle of plays for every decade of the African American experience. And so he's written a play that represents each decade up until now. And as I said, he's continuing to work on that project. We're actually going to see a short clip from one of his plays, Fences, which is from the 1950s. That's the decade that this is representing. And it's an interesting representation of the sort of experiences that African Americans were having and the sorts of families and social groups that they were a part of at this time. So let's take a quick look at this clip from Fences by August Wilson.
Your mama tells me you done got recruited by one of them college football teams. Is that right?
Yeah. Coach Zeldin say the recruiter gonna be coming by to see you, get you to sign the permission papers.
I thought you were supposed to be working down there at that A&P. Ain't you supposed to be working down there at the school?
Well, Mr. Starwicky say he gonna hold my job for me at the A&P until after the football season.
Now, I thought we had an understanding about all this here. You supposed to be keeping up your grades and holding down your job at that A&P. Ain't been around here all day on a Saturday. Ain't none of your chores been done. And now you telling me you didn't quit your job?
Well, you said I could be working weekends. I'm gonna be working weekends.
You doggone right you is. So ain't no need of nobody coming by here to ask me to sign nothing.
Oh, come on, Pop. You can't do that. He's coming all the way from North Carolina.
Hey, I don't care where that white man coming from. Hey, he ain't gonna let you get nowhere with this football stuff. So you go ahead on and keep your grades up so you can hold that job down at the A&P. Or learn how to fix cars or build houses. Learn you a trade. That way you got something can't nobody take away from you. Yeah, you go ahead on and learn how to do something with your hands besides hauling people's garbage.
I get good grades, Pop. That's why the recruiter wants to see you. You gotta keep up your grades to get recruited. This way I'll be in college.
The first thing you gonna do is go down there and see if you can't get your job back.
I'm gonna be working weekends.
You getting out of here and going to see if you can't find you another job now.
Oh, come on, Pop. I gotta practice. The team needs me. That's what Coach Zelman says.
Hey, man, I don't care what nobody say. I'm the boss around here. You understand that? I'm the boss around here. I'm the only one that does the saying that counts.
Oh, come on, Pop.
Now, I ask you, now, do you understand?
Yeah.
What?
Yes, sir.
You get your behind on down there to that A&P and see if you can't get your job back. If you can't do both, then you quit the football team. You got to take the crooked with the straight.
Yes. How come you ain't never liked me?
Like you? Who the heck says I got to like you, huh? What law is there says I got to like you? Want to stand up in my face and ask a dumb fool question like that, talking about liking somebody? Now you come back here, boy, when I'm talking to you. Now straighten up. Now I ask you a question. Now what law is there says I got to like you?
None.
Well, all right then. Don't you eat every day?
Yeah.
Boy, as long as you live in this house, you put the sir on the end of it when you're talking to me.
Yes, sir.
Don't you eat every day?
Yes.
Got a roof over your head?
Yes, sir.
Keep your belly full of my food?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, well, why do you think that is?
Because of you.
Oh, heck, boy, I know it's because of me, but why do you think that is? Like you. I go out of here every day, bust my behind, putting up with them white folks because I like you. You is a...
So an interesting scene from Fences. I think a really interesting look at not only the relationship between a father and a son at that time, but also sort of the future prospects for someone in that position and how it sort of clearly lays out at least the father's viewpoint on that at the time, which was then, and I think we even see that in A Raisin in the Sun, this feeling that the most practical thing to do for an African-American person at the time is not to get an education or to have these lofty dreams, but to do something very practical, to get a skill that you're going to be able to use to support your family. And I think that really speaks to sort of the limitations that the African-American community had accepted at that time, and for good reasons. But that they felt like they couldn't move beyond what society had kind of laid out for them, and we see that reflected in that wonderful scene there. All right, what about Asian American theater? We've had three different waves of Asian immigration into America. First, the Chinese came in the 1850s, and a huge amount of them actually ended up here in California in the north and across the west and the Midwest working on the railroad. The Japanese in the 20th century and the Southeast Asians in the 1970s, obviously as a result of an unfortunate amount of war in Southeast Asia. And All of these things contributed to stereotyping in mainstream theater and film. They were viewed only as cooks. For those of you that have seen Happy Days, that's a very recent sort of stereotype that Asians work in as cooks. We may not see that so much today, but that is definitely a stereotype that has come to us from the past. Spies and evil old men that were trying to, what they used to call, Shanghai you in the night to kidnap you and sell you, or put you in an opium den somewhere and keep you as a slave. And they were also looked at as sort of these submissive people, especially the women. But in the 1960s, this started changing in terms of the types of theater that were trying to provide other representations for Asians across America, and especially in theater. The East West Players in LA is a wonderful theater company that came about in the 60s and still exists today. And they continue to do amazing work that works to represent Asians in all of their diversity and complexity in an authentic way. Philip Kangutunda wrote a play called The Wash, and this is about the problems that immigrants face assimilating into American culture and how it causes a lot of intergenerational stress. And David Henry Hwang also wrote The Golden Child, which is a wonderful play about Christianity coming into China in the late 19th century. In Butterfly was another wonderful play written by David Henry Hwang. It's one of my favorites, actually. And the synopsis of this is in chapter 7, but it's about a French diplomat who ends up, who's trying to plan his conquest of a Chinese opera singer. He's also trying to spy to a certain extent on the Chinese government. And he revels in having her submit to him. There's definitely an interesting power struggle that happens there with the French male sort of enjoying dominating this Chinese female. But eventually he finds out that the woman that he's fallen in love with and has been having this love affair with for all these months is actually not a woman at all, but a man and a Chinese spy. And the only reason why this woman wanted to have any kind of a relationship with the man was because he was trying to get information out of the French diplomat. So the sort of the power structure ends up switching. And there's just this wonderful switch at the end that is so surprising and shocking. If you've never read the play, you're just totally blown away by it. So a wonderful play that was written by David Henry Hwang. Hispanic American theater also has gone through many developments over its time here. Obviously, it comes down to us, the Aztecs and the Mayans and the Hispanics were living here in America and in Mexico long before many of the rest of us. And they have a long history of ritualized dramas with masks and costumes. And when, of course, the French and the Spanish came in, especially the Spanish, they considered a lot of this as heresy, and as they did with many of the other natives that were living here, they encouraged them basically not to engage in any of these rituals and any of these theatrical events, because to them it was worshiping heathen gods, and so it was a pagan thing, and it was going to send them all to hell. So, you know, they destroyed a lot of the ritual and the drama that was existent before. And they tried to teach the dogma, the new dogma, the Christian dogma, to the natives through a lot of theater that was talking about the Bible and the stories of the Bible, very much like what happened in Europe in the medieval times. But drama in the Southwest and theater out of the Hispanic culture has evolved and reignited. In the 60s, we had Luis Valdez and the Teatro Campesino, which came about and was a way for a lot of the migrant workers that were working on farms to have a voice. To especially during the grape strikes and a lot of the other strikes that occurred at the time, Luis Valdez would go into these communities and would do theatrical performances, improv scenes with strikers, and would ask them to talk about and deal with the problems and help to educate other workers about what was happening. These were called actos, and they focused on social problems. And other teatros then began to spring up as well. And in fact, even here on campus, we have a small multicultural children's theater company based on this sort of idea, and it's called Teatro Dominguez. And we do all sorts of multicultural events. We'll be having that class on campus next semester in the fall. And we do plays, we do play readings that are by multicultural authors. We also do plays that have are taken from multicultural folk tales and stories that help to educate young people about social issues, just in the same way that the original teatro worked across California and the Southwest. Contemporary writers that write in this sort of form of social justice are also Octavio Solis, who wrote Man of the Flesh, Sherry Moraga, who writes about heroes and saints and fighting against government incompetence, and of course, Valdez, who also wrote Zoot Suit. Which is an amazing sort of play, musical sort of thing. It's a wonderful play about the Zoot Suiters in the 50s and 60s. So Native American theater is also an important thing for us to look at here in America. We know that the variety of Indians that lived across America long before the colonists got here, and they also have a long history of ritual-based theater, similar to Asian forms of theater, using symbolic dance, like we saw in the Bali trance dances, and also other forms that have to do with calling on gods to create balance and harmony within the tribe. And they've not only had to deal with the genocide of their people as colonists from the European countries came in and took over their lands and killed a wide variety of them from all different tribes, but also a lot of stereotyping that has come down that many of us, I think, have a hard time even recognizing because it has been around for so long. But the 60s, as with, you know, so many of these, brought around a sort of movement in the Native and the First Nation community that reacted to these stereotypes and these treatments in plays. And they wanted to talk about the differences that they perceived, how the West was stereotyping them. And there were a lot of revivals of different forms that had come down through the generations in Native theater. Hanne Geoma wrote The Spider Woman, which is an interesting, wonderful play based around Native myths and storytelling, and others like Denver Center Black Elk Speaks. And in fact, a recent play that's come out deals with some Native American themes. They actually made a film of it as well, which is August Osage County, which is now a film. I think Julia Roberts and Meryl Streep were in it, but it was a play first and also deals with Native American themes. Finally, we're going to talk about today women's theater or feminist theater. And women across cultures, we know, have always been in a sort of secondary citizen status. And this goes back many, many generations. And so minority women have faced different things, but women across the board, whether they be Caucasian or from minority groups, have faced discrimination as well as differing rights from men. And so we can trace feminist theater and women's theater back very, very far in terms of different types of female writers and philosophers who were trying to make inroads into the world of theater. Some of the early pioneers were Afroban Sor Juana in Spain and Andreini. Anna Cora Mowat was a really well-known female playwright and actress in the 19th century. And she sort of made it acceptable in America to be a writer for the theater and actually to also be an actress. She wrote a wonderful play that was sort of poking fun at New York elite, and her play became very successful. There was also the women's independent movement, and of course, a host of modern writers that we see today, such as Beth Henley, who wrote Crimes of the Heart, Marcia Norman, who wrote Night Mother, Eve Ensler, who wrote The Vagina Monologues and speaks out against violence against women. And we can move forward and talk about even now women like Sarah Rule, who wrote plays like In the Next Room or The Vibrator Play, which talks about a huge amount of women's issues. Eurydice, which is a play based on a Greek myth and talks about this female character in a very empowering way. So we have so many women who are in the theater now and talking and making a voice for women and women's issues. And we've come so far from where we were before, where women weren't even allowed on the stage and barely let allowed in it, especially if you were in Spain, you couldn't even watch the play with the rest of the men. So now we've developed and we are a voice to be reckoned with within the world of theater. Well, that covers our theater of diversity for this part of the broadcast. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about musical theater, which is chapter 13. So I'll see you back here in about 5 minutes, and we'll continue on with the broadcast for today.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
The 2015 Special Olympics World Games will be the largest sporting and humanitarian event to take place in 2015. We're very excited that LA was chosen for this event, and even more excited that the city of Carson and the university have decided to take part in the host town program.
Almost 200 million people around the world have intellectual disabilities. Late Eunice Kennedy Shriver had an incredible vision that she could change their lives through the simple power of sports and thereby transform communities around the world as they come in contact with our athletes.
And I'm even happy too that I get to see two of my close athletes, friends, and Special Olympics has totally, totally changed my life.
Mrs. Shriver's vision has resulted in more than 4.2 million athletes in 177 countries around the world, participating in about 70,000 events a year in Special Olympics.
CSVGH is very, very thrilled then to continue this long tradition by hosting a delegation of athletes and their coaches as they prepare to compete in the 2015 Special Olympics World Games. I wish to acknowledge Mayor Jim Deere and the Carson City Council for inviting CSVGH to partner with them in host town duties.
This campus is the most ethnically diverse campus in the entire system, and so the message that was just given to you about the inclusion, the diversity, it's so poignant and appropriate for Carson and Cal State University Dominguez Hills.
And it is so much more meaningful and heartwarming when we have a personal connection with them, because they'll be living with us and our students and the campus during July.
Inside the Circle of Acceptance and Inclusion, which is our primary mission, and the multicolors represent the diversity of 177 countries and the diversity of Los Angeles, and how we can reach every corner of this community with the message of acceptance and inclusion. To the mayor of the city, to the city council, and to the provost of California State University, Dominguez Hills, congratulations on being named an official host town.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Theater 100. In this next part of our broadcast, we're going to talk about musical theater, which is chapter 15 in your book. I do want to remind you that we are live and online. 1-800-339-1193 is where you can reach us on the phone. And you can always send us an email at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. And that brings me to the question of the day for the second part of our broadcast. And that is, have you ever seen a musical on stage? And if so, what did you think? And if you haven't seen a musical, then what musical movie did you enjoy? And there have been so many musical movies made even in the last 10 years that you should have at least seen one of those. So let me know about if you have seen a musical, which part did you enjoy if it was live? And if not, what did you enjoy about a musical movie that you saw? So where did the origins of musical theater come from? A lot of students, when I ask them that question, they automatically say, well, opera, it has to be opera. Actually, musical theater has a very different lineage than opera. If you remember, opera goes back to the Italians' misinterpretation of the Greek classical texts. They thought that when there was indication that the chorus should sing certain parts, they thought that that meant that all of the parts should be sung. And so they sort of inadvertently invented a whole new form of theater, which was these sort of very dramatic, as classical Greek and Roman theater plays are, forms of theater that are all sung. We know now that that wasn't the way that Greek and Roman theater was actually performed. It was only the choral bits of the play that were sung, and sometimes those weren't sung. They were chanted, and sometimes they weren't even chanted. They were just spoken. But that misinterpretation led to the opera. As opposed to musical theater as we know it now, or oftentimes what we call like a book musical, which is a musical in which we have the same amount of lines as we spoken lines as we do have music. This has a very different lineage, and we can trace it back really to things like operetta and melodrama in America. And in that way, it is a very specific American form of theater. The way that musicals are done, as we know them in the golden age of musicals, all happened here in America. And that was because we had some specific developments here that sort of generated this style of theater. As I said, melodrama was one of the things that was a contributor to developing this style of theater. And just to refresh your memory, remember that melodrama was a theater that focused on actions rather than internal conflicts. So external conflicts rather than internal conflicts had a lot of spectacular effects. And there was music playing underneath things to enhance the emotionality of the scene. We can see that a lot of musicals, especially older musicals, adhere to that. One of the other things that was prominent in melodrama was very clear heroes and villains. And again, this is something that we see over and over again, especially in early musicals, where we have very sort of simple storylines that are focused more on action and external conflicts than internal conflicts, and that the good guys and the bad guys are usually really clearly defined. Minstrel shows also contributed to this idea of musical theater. Again, to remind you, this was this form of theater that had a lot of singing and dancing and other sort of variety acts interspersed in between. Those might be a poem read or a monologue or some sort of dramatic reading or jokes. And out of that form grew a lot of other forms. You would remember that this form, as we just said before the break, was performed primarily by African Americans, but it did change over time. It was first performed by Caucasians, then primarily African Americans, and then it did change over time. And as I said, Bert Williams really changed the whole style of minstrel shows by putting the performers in tuxedos and top hats and gloves and tailcoats, and had a wonderful chorus of African-American women singing and dancing. So this was a style of theater that sort of changed over time to a more crude comedic form to a very elegant style of theater. And in that, we can kind of see connections to the musicals that we see Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers performing in very elegant, very classy sorts of performances with songs and dancing in a very formal attire. This also added to and contributed to two other styles of theater that were really uniquely American, and that's vaudeville and burlesque. And vaudeville is a style of theater that is a variety act, basically. So variety performers, and none of these performers have to have relationships to each other. So for instance, you might have a comedy group like Abbott and Costello, two men or a man and a woman who are a comedy team, and they do jokes together and they do little skits together that are funny. Then you might have a group of kids that do a dancing act and singing act, and then you might have a woman that comes on and does some sort of acrobatics. And so the evening's night of performances is really a variety act. It's a lot of different things. A lot of times the people who were producing for the theater would sort of string the acts together in a complementary way, but they weren't there in a traditional way. There was no story, and there was really not even thematic connection necessarily. They might just be structured in a way that we didn't have three dances in a row and three comedy acts in a row. They were structured in a way to provide the variety that people were looking for. These were also acts that were very family friendly, and that a lot of people, this is the time before movie theaters, so people often would go out to these vaudeville acts and take their family as a way to have some entertainment in the evenings. And these were very similar to the minstrels, but again, this was not all African American performers. This was a wide variety of performers, and sometimes even foreign performers in the shows. Burlesque was a style of theater that developed after vaudeville, at the tail end of vaudeville, and it actually ended up taking over vaudeville. Vaudeville eventually died out, and burlesque was the style of theater that became more dominant. I know when I say burlesque now to a lot of students, what you think about is like Kat Von D or something, and women dancing around with feather boas and sitting in champagne glasses, and that's not to say that that isn't a part of burlesque. But what burlesque originally was really more of a variety act, but with less of a family bent. Originally, the style came out as an offshoot of vaudeville, and it simply was the same sort of variety act, but with more adult humor and scenes. And that doesn't necessarily mean racy. It just means off-color humor, or things that you wouldn't think would be appropriate to take your 10-year-old to. So, the way these started out was obviously, there would be a vaudeville show, and then later on in that evening, in the same theater perhaps, a burlesque show would go on, and this would be something more for adult entertainment. Eventually, burlesque did develop and it became very adult. And yes, it did include a lot of sort of striptease acts and some very off-color humor and things like that. But that was not the way it started, and it wasn't only that. It had a wide variety in it. But it did eventually end up taking over, and vaudeville became sort of a thing of the past, and burlesque surpassed it. So out of these many different variations on a theme, we eventually get things which are the step right before we get musical theater, and that's musical comedy. And in early 20th century, there were a lot of musical comedies that were written by people like George M. Cohan, Jerome Kern, Irving Berlin, and Porter and others. And what these were was kind of like the progenitor to musicals. They were pieces that were performed, lots of music, singing and stuff in it, but not necessarily a very cohesive story. So, for instance, we might have two or three scenes that go together that are kind of a story about one thing that's humorous, and some songs that go in between that are maybe thematically related, but aren't necessarily part of the scene. They may not even be sung by people who are performing the scene. They may be sung by some other singer that comes in to sing these songs, or group of singers that come in to sing these songs. And this could these could be scenes that are of all different nature with different characters, and it basically was with music interspersed. Again, that wasn't about the characters singing about their experience, but were merely thematically related to the scenes that you were seeing. And they were often very humorous, lighthearted in tone. But as you can see, it's only a hop, skip, and a jump before we're off into musical theater. And this is where eventually we end up with what is considered the first true piece of American musical theater, with Showboat, which was written in 1927. This is a really significant shift in that we have a piece of theater that has one story that runs the course of the show from the beginning to the end, and the songs are directly related to the story. Not just thematically related, but directly related to the storyline. Now, not as related as, say, we're going to see later on as we're looking at later plays, like from the Golden Age, but definitely related. We also get Porgy and Bess, and Porgy and Bess is about an African-American couple that are in love, that kind of have this situation where they can't be with each other in the way that they want to be. And this was written by George Gershwin. The music was written all by George Gershwin, and this was written in 1935. And this is, again, another musical that has a storyline that starts at the beginning and goes to the end and has related music that goes with it. One of the songs that you might know from this play that is around even today, I bet you could hum it if I gave you the tune, it's A Summertime. A Summertime and the Living is Easy, right? So that song is actually from Porgy and Bess. And again, we can listen to that, and if we see it in the context of the play, we see how it's related to the story of the play, but it's not really conveying the inner thoughts or the dialogue or moving the storyline forward in any way. The songs here in these musicals still almost act as musical interludes, even though they're more integrated into the story than they were before. They're not really characters talking about what's happening right now in the action or plot of the play, revealing inner feelings, or even singing to another character and going back and forth and having a song that actually moves the plot forward. Oklahoma, it begins us here at the beginning of what we call the Golden Age of musical theater in America, and it was written by Rodgers and Hammerstein, and the choreography was by Agnes DeMille, who choreographed a great many musicals in the Golden Era. It has a very classical feeling, but the story is told in a very unlikely setting, the Wild West of the Americas. It's got murder as a subject. But it begins us in the Golden Age. And so we're going to take a little look here at one of the dance sequences in Oklahoma to give you a sort of feel of the types of musicals that were coming out at this time in America, in the world of musical theater. wonderful dance sequence that happens at the barn dance, and we see an interesting mix of sort of balletic moves mixed with older traditional square dancing forms from America. And so we see sort of this conglomeration of things happening. Also in this play, there's something that sort of carried forward in a lot of plays at musicals after this, and that was what we call the ballet sequence, or the big dance sequence. And this happens in Oklahoma, and we see it in a wide variety of other musicals after this. There was this feeling that that was sort of necessary to create this big dance interlude somewhere in the piece. And it was an opportunity to showcase some of the better dancers as well as to showcase some higher technique, some dance technique. And so this kind of carries on, and we can see that this is kind of a leftover from some of the sort of variety acts of the past, right, where we see in operetta as well as vaudeville as well as the minstrel shows where there would always be one big dance number that everyone sort of looked forward to, and we carry this through through most of the golden age of musicals. So the 1950s is considered the golden age of the American musical, and in this time we get a ton of book musicals that are written. Again, a book musical is a musical that has about 50% dialogue and 50% music. It's the integrated musical, which also means that all of the music that's in the play is sung by the actors, and all of the dancing is danced by the actors as well as maybe some other dancers that are brought in. The music is strongly connected to the storyline and to the characters themselves. It's not a time to sing a song that's kind of related. It's a time to sing a song that moves the story forward or tells us more about the character. So plays like Carousel in South Pacific, which were written in 1949, Guys and Dolls, which were written in 1950, and The King and I in 1951, as well as The Sound of Music, which all of you should be familiar with now because Lady Gaga sang that beautiful melange from Sound of Music at the Oscars, this last Oscar season. And also My Fair Lady by Lerner and Lowe, which was based on Bernard Shaw's Pygmalion, which was based on an even earlier Greek piece of theater also called Pygmalion. And the original story is about a Greek sculptor who's sculpting a piece of marble into a man, actually, and this man becomes alive, and he has to teach the man how to be a human being. And Bernard Shaw's Pygmalion is actually kind of a spin on that, where it's about a man, an upper-class man, trying to teach a lower-class woman how to be a lady and how to fit in with upper-class society. And My Fair Lady is really based more on that story. And it's all about this main character here, played by Audrey Hepburn, who is a sort of street urchin sort of gal. She lives on the streets. She's a lower class. She doesn't live on the streets, but she peddles things on the streets. And she is taken in by an upper class gentleman who's a addiction professor, and he makes a bet with somebody that he can make her fit in with the upper class society in a certain amount of time and debut her at this big dance that they're going to have. And so it's a wonderful little story, and it's definitely well acted by Audrey Hepburn and Marnie Nixon as well. So let's look at a little clip from My Fair Lady. I think we have a clip. Yes, we do.
I know your headaches. I know you're tired. I know your nerves are as raw as meat in a butcher's window. But think what you're trying to accomplish. Just think what you're dealing with. The majesty and grandeur of the English language is the greatest possession we have. The noblest thoughts that ever flowed through the hearts of men are contained in its extraordinary, imaginative, and musical mixtures of sounds. And that's what you've set yourself out to conquer, Eliza. And conquer it, you will.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
Again.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
I think she's got it. I think she's got it.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
By George, she's got it. By George, she's got it. Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain, on the plain.
And where's that soggy plain?
Scene. I'm sure many of you have seen it before, the rain in Spain, and that's the first moment that Eliza is able to speak in an RP accent correctly. Up until that point, she's speaking in a Cockney accent, and so a wonderful little scene from My Fair Lady. West Side Story is also from this period of time. We're not going to watch a clip from it, but for those of you that have seen it know that it's a wonderful tale, sort of Romeo and Juliet tale translated into the 1950s. Also, The Music Man is from this period. It's actually from in the end of the 1950s, about 1960, but it's an interesting story about a man who comes into a town and actually tries to swindle all of the townspeople. And this is a scene from the opening, and the music here is just really fantastic. And in fact, I don't know if it was this Oscars or, you know what, it was this year's Tonys. They actually did this this sequence. And I think that there were some very famous hip hop musicians that did it, but it was really fantastic and very interesting because when you listen to this piece, it's very, very rhythmic and it lends itself very well to that sort of translation. But anyways, this is a clip from The Music Man, the opening.
Let him go, Orville. I guess we made it plain. We don't want no more traveling salesmen in Brighton. Credit is no good for an ocean salesman.
How far are you going, friend?
Wherever the people are as green as the money, friend.
What's the matter with credit?
It's old-fashioned. Charlie, you're an anvil salesman. Your firm give credit?
No, sir.
Nor anybody else.
River City, next station stop, River City Highway.
Cash for the merchandise. Cash for the button hooks.
Cash for the cotton goods. Cash for the hard goods.
Cash for the fancy goods. Cash for the soft goods.
Cash for the noggins and the piggins and the frickins.
Cash for the hogshead cask and demijohn. Cash for the crackers and the pickles and the fly paper.
Look, what do you talk? What do you talk? What do you talk? What do you talk? What do you talk?
Where do you get it?
What do you talk?
You can talk, you can talk. You can bigger, you can talk. You can bigger, bigger, bigger. You can talk, you can talk. You can talk, 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 talk. Bigger, bigger, bigger. You can talk all you want, but it's different than it was.
No, it ain't, no, it ain't. But you gotta know the territory.
Shh, 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 shh. Why, it's the Model T Ford. Made the trouble, made the people wanna go. Wanna get, wanna get up and go. 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 14, 22, 23 miles to the county seat.
Yes, sir, yes,
So isn't that wonderful? This is very, very rhythmic, chanty sort of song that's talking about how all these salesmen and are living and the different sorts of environments and things that they encounter on their journeys. Wonderful. Bye Bye Birdie was also came out around 1962, and again we're sort of coming to the end of the golden age of musical theater. Before we see this clip, I do want to remind you, because the number just flashed up on the screen, we do have a second question for this part of the broadcast. So if any of you would like to type in or call in to talk about what your favorite musical is, if you've seen one, and if you haven't, what your favorite part of a film musical was that you've seen. We haven't had anyone type in yet, so hopefully some of you will respond to that question in the remaining moments of our broadcast here. But let's look at this little clip from Bye Bye Birdie. This is a really great example of how the music in these musicals had changed from originally to just being these interludes to being really integrated and part of the story and revealing, in fact, more of the plot line. So this is a song, Lovely to Be a Woman, which is from Bye Bye Birdie.
A skinny child of 15, wired with braces from ear to ear, you doubt that you will ever be appealing. Then, hallelujah, you are 16 and the braces disappear, and your skin is smooth and clear, and you have that happy grown-up female feeling. How lovely to be a woman, the wait was well worthwhile. How lovely to wear mascara and smile a woman's smile. How lovely to have a figure that's round instead of black. Whenever you hear boys whistle, you're what they're whistling at. It's wonderful to be the way a woman feels. It gives you such a glow just to know job to do, to pick out a boy and train him, and then when you are through, you've made him a man you want him to be. How lovely to be a woman like me. How wonderful to know the things a woman knows. How marvelous to wait for a date in simply beautiful clothes. How lovely to be a woman and change from boys to men, to go to a fancy nightclub and stay out after 10. How lovely to be so grown up and free.
So the dramatic irony in that song is that she's talking about how lovely it is to be a woman while she's dressing up to be a boy so that she can go out to this concert, right? So a very entertaining song, and it tells us a lot about the character and her internal state. Hello Dolly comes out in 1964 along with Fiddler on the Roof, and these two musicals really mark the end of the Great Book musical, because after that point we get a real shift in the sorts of musicals that are being written and the way that the musicals are being constructed. They really change throughout the rest of the 1960s, starting with Cabaret, moving forward with a musical like Hair that was written by McDermott and Ragney and has naked people on stage and talks about the sort of hippie revolution and the ideals of love and peace. The Wiz, which was a take on The Wizard of Oz. That's a lovely full shot of Hair. There are lots of people reviving this musical right now, which I think is very interesting. But The Wiz was another one that came out in 1975, and this was a take on The Wizard of Oz, done with an all-African-American cast. Obviously, the film version, done with Michael Jackson in it as well. And Diana Ross, I think, right? And Ain't Misbehavin', which was the music done by Fats Waller, and was sort of a return, in a way, to some of the musicals of the past, in that it wasn't a really connected storyline. It was really a bunch of vignettes interspersed with the music of Fats Waller. And so that was really a new and interesting take on kind of going backwards in time to the way things had been done. Also, Jelly's Last Jam was a very similar thing, where we had music based on Jelly Roll Morton and featuring George C. Wolfe. And this was a similar idea, where we had these vignettes and they connected in a way, and they were all united really, though, by the music of Jelly Roll Morton. The chorus line comes out as well. This is really changing the structure of the way things are done. Not only is it very meta in form, meaning that it's a piece of work that's sort of aware of itself and commenting on itself. This is a story about a group of actors auditioning to be in a musical. And we get to see what they go through and their whole process of auditioning. And in, you know, in between, we get these songs that talk about their inner life and the trials that they've gone through. Some wonderful music in here that probably a lot of us are familiar with, even if we don't know it. And some very interesting techniques, in that we get these characters with these monologues, kind of doing these flashback vignettes almost, and then singing a song, and different kinds of scenes that we had not seen before on the stage. Sweeney Todd is another well-known musical from this era that, again, is very different. What is this musical about? It's about a serial killer, basically. We just watched this in my lecture course in 100. And when someone asked me, what is this about? I said, well, it's about a serial killer. a very unusual thing to write a musical about. It's about a man whose wife and child were taken from him by a judge who's in town. Who's the judge in the town, and he was wrongly accused of a crime and sent to prison so that this judge could marry his wife and take his daughter. The wife apparently goes off and kills herself with arsenic. We don't find out till later that's not actually true, and the child becomes the ward of the judge and ends up being raised by him. When he gets out of jail, he ends up hating the world and becoming a misanthrope and wanting desperately to exact revenge on the judge and on the city that betrayed him. This is a wonderful production shot. And so in the productions, typical productions of Sweeney Todd, there is a lot of blood and gore. There's this spectacular effect of these people whom Sweeney Todd murders by cutting their necks because he used to be a barber. In one of the original productions, Angela Lansbury plays Mrs. Lovett. This is a baker who lives in the shop below where Sweeney Todd used to live with his wife. And he comes back to this spot and he meets with Mrs. Lovett. And he ends up making friends with her, and they end up kind of being this pair that work together throughout the rest of the musical. There's a wonderful clip here with Angela Lansbury playing Mrs. Lovett and Len Carew as Sweeney Todd. And this is one of the wonderful songs that Mrs. Lovett sings in the in the production of Sweeney Todd, which I'm pretty sure we have a clip of there.
Stephen Sondheim's beautiful and bloody Sweeney Todd tells the story of a London barber, originally played by my friend Len Carew, who returns maddened from an unjust prison sentence to take his revenge by slitting the throats of his clients and having their bodies made by his equally crazed associate into pies. Angela Lansbury, unquestionably one of the theater's greatest all-around talents, plays Mrs. Lovett in a kind of 19th century maniacal version of rap as she bakes and sings at a frenzied pace about what are absolutely the worst pies in London.
one minute, can't you sit? Sit you down, sit. All I meant is that I haven't seen a customer for weeks. Did you come in for a pie, sir? Do forgive me if my head's a little fake. What is that? But you think we have the plague? From the way that people keep avoiding, no you don't. Have another try, sir. But there's no one comes in even to inhale. Right you are, sir, would you like a drop of ale? Mind you, I can't hardly blame them. These are probably the worst pies in London. I know why nobody cares to take them. I should know, I make them. But good now, the worst pies in London. Even that's polite, the worst pies in London. If you doubt it, take a bite. Is that just disgusting? You have to conceive it. It's nothing but crusting. You drink this, you'll need it. The worst pies in London. And no wonder when the price of it's what it is. When you get it, never thought I'd live to see the day. Men are thinking it was a treat, finding poor animals what are dying in the street. Mrs. Mooney has a pie shop, does a business, but I've noticed something weird. Likely all her neighbours' cats have disappeared. Have to add it to her, what a cause, enterprise, popping pussies into pies. Wouldn't do in my shop, just a thought of it's enough to make you sick. And I'm telling you, the pussy cats is quick. No denying times is hard, sir, even harder than the worst pies in London. Only ladder, nothing more, is that just revolting, all greasy and gritty. It looks like it's molting and tastes like, well, pity a woman alone with limited wind. And the worst pies in London. Oh, sir, times is hard, times is hard.
So that's a wonderful little sequence there with Angela Lansbury playing Mrs. Lovett. And she eventually befriends Sweeney Todd, and as the narrator was saying, ends up making his human victims into pies, into meat for the pies. So it's a very dark, dark musical, not at all like Bye Bye Birdie or Music Man or any of the musicals that came before. And another big difference with Sweeney Todd is that we're seeing a shift in the style and structure of the book musical. The book musical, as I said, is disappearing, and we're getting plays like Sweeney Todd, which are primarily music. Even if you've seen the film version of Sweeney Todd, you know that there's very little dialogue. There's more music in that play than there is dialogue, and most of the story is told through songs. So that's another big difference, is that in some ways it's closer to an opera in certain elements than it is to a play, a straight play. In the late 70s and the 80s, we get the rise of the British musical. We get a lot of British musicals coming out, Les Miserables, Jesus Christ Superstar, Phantom of the Opera, and Miss Saigon in 1989. I'm sure a lot of us are familiar with Les Mis. It's one of the most done musicals, along with Phantom, on Broadway, and it's also been made into several films now. I mean, seems like every few years they're making that musical into a film. And again, another example of a musical that is mostly music and has very, very little dialogue, right? As we move forward, we get Evita, which is the story of Evita from Brazil, from South America. Eva Perón, and her nickname was Evita. And of course, we know that the film version was done. There's a wonderful production video, but we know the film version was done with Madonna, and that was a very interesting take on that. But there's been lots and lots of musical versions as well. And then we also get another very famous one, Cats, which is a play that, again, sort of goes back to this original structure of having a not really having a story, right? What it's about is really a bunch of cats that live in this alley and little stories about cats and sometimes poems about cats and the songs that they sing. And there's some really lovely music in Cats. And it's more about something that's thematically connected than it is about something that has a whole story. So as we continue to move forward in the world of the musical, we after we get out of the 80s, we move into the 90s, and now in the 2000s, we have such a wide variety of musicals that are coming about, and lots of different structures, lots of different definitions being pushed in terms of what a musical really is and what it's about. We're actually going to have a whole nother class on musicals that deals with what we call postmodern musicals, which are musicals from the last now 25 years, from the 90s all the way until now. And we're going to take a look at some of the more modern takes on musical theater, some of the musicals that have been made into films, and some of the films that were never musicals, like Across the Universe, that have started coming about as well. So a really interesting world of musical theater that we have yet to explore. Strange new forms, strange new stories. But the one thing that I think musical theater maintains is its sense of largeness for the most part. Although, again, even with that, I can think of some musicals that break those rules. But a lot of the big Broadway shows really are about spectacle and spectacular things happening and some really wonderful inventiveness and creativeness, especially when we think about things like The Lion King, different ways to approach things. The musical is expansive and it has such a wide canvas to paint on and so many things at its disposal. So it's been able to do a wide variety of things and it's continuing to transform and the stories that it's telling are continuing to transform as well. Well, guys, we covered a lot today. We talked about a lot of things and goodness, a lot of things. So I just want to remind you, please make sure that you take your midterm by the end of this week. I don't think there is a discussion board visit this week. In fact, I'm pretty sure there's not. There's not a discussion board next week. So all you really need to focus on is getting that midterm done by midnight tomorrow night. You're going to have a week break. And then when we come back, we'll finish up with the rest of our 5 or 6 weeks of class. Thanks. Bye.